Put your hands together and join me in welcoming the incomparable Miss Val to the podium. Where are we?
Everybody up, we gotta get this party started. Let's go, everybody up. It's time to dance. Right? Here we go, let's loosen up, people. How fun is that? Life is short. Don't wait to dance. Got it? Okay. I'm super excited. I was watching all of those stats that were going up about women, and I got so excited. Beth, thank you for sharing all of that. And I just heard a stat yesterday that, yes, I am now known as the coach of Caitlin Ohashi. But I heard a stat that her video is seen more than any other male or female sports video in the world. Yep, she's only this tall, but she is mighty. I'm very, very honored to be here. I love what this conference stands for, and I love being a Bruin and all that UCLA stands for. Yeah. And if I'm gonna be making that entrance every time, I gotta work out more. Goodness gracious sakes alive, as Coach Wooden would say. So Al, thank you so much for that introduction. And I heard you all go, ooh, when he said I was Pac-12 Coach of the Century. You went, ooh, she's old, yeah. I get it. I've been at UCLA 36 years. Have won 7 national championships, all that. I'm in the into the UCLA Athletic Hall of Fame, which is super cool. And I'm telling you all this because the most important stat for all of you out here, especially you younger girls that are here with us today, high school, I'm telling you all those stats because I'm one of the most decorated coaches that's coaching in college of any sport, and I've never done gymnastics. I know. I went upside down once. It was last year on my 58th birthday, and my girlfriend said, it's high time you go upside down, so do a cartwheel. And I did a cartwheel, and I got halfway up, and my bum came right down towards the camera. And on the video, you hear my girlfriend say, oh, that was horrible. So I went upside down, but I wasn't successful. The point of the story, obviously, is how did I do it? And that's why I wrote the book. Because the book is all about how did a dancer, choreographer, become one of the most celebrated coaches in athletic history. And I'm gonna tell you the short version of that because I want you to read the long version. You guys are great. Short version is, I was getting to start my inaugural season with the Washington, D.C. Ballet in 1982. Yay! Go ballet. And I was 22 years old. I'd not gone to college, although I really loved college. I loved learning and I wanted to go back to college. And I heard that UCLA needed a dance coach for their gymnastics team. So lesson number one from what I'm gonna talk about today. Without any hesitation, I found out who the head coach was, I got his number, I called him up, and I gave him my credentials, and just that quickly he said, we don't have a salary for you, but I can give you a full scholarship if you've not gone to school. And I hadn't gone to school. And I was like, done. And that quickly, I retired from dancing. I moved from Washington, D.C. to Los Angeles in the fall of 1982, and I have been here ever since. That would have never, ever happened had I been too afraid to make the ask. Got it? I'm seeing the heads go like this. right? They didn't call me. I called them. Luckily, I grew up in a family where my parents never instilled fear of failure in us. I don't believe in the word failure. I believe that failure is simply another F word that somebody made up to make us feel badly about ourselves. And it should be erased from the dictionary. And I'm going to prove to you why failure doesn't exist. Because if you set out to achieve a goal and you don't achieve the goal, if you take the time to stop and debrief and think, what did I do that was good? What didn't work? What do I need to do better next time? You have learned something. If you learn something in life along the way, how can it be failure? It can't. It doesn't exist. Erase it from your vocabulary. So they bring me in as a dance coach choreographer. I'm at UCLA. I'm living the life, living the dream. I graduate with honors in history. I loved every moment of my college career. And I was going to go be a journalist, yet I was still choreographing for the team. And 1990, the athletic director calls me in her office and says, we're going to make a change with our head coach, and we would like for you to be the new head coach. And I thought, I laughed out loud immediately. She says I became catatonic and I didn't breathe. But eventually I laughed out loud. And I said to her, you get it? I don't know the first thing about gymnastics. And she said, I like the way, I've observed how you act with your student athletes, and I like the way that you teach them and coach them and mentor them. And I trust you'll figure the rest out. I'm like, can I get any more? She goes, no, just go figure it out. So I did what I thought was the very, very smart thing to do. I grew up on stage. I didn't grow up in athletics. Not the first thing, like this whole, ooh, winning, we gotta go beat them, you know, bragging rights. That is so not in my DNA. I did not grow up with that. How am I supposed to lead one of the premier programs in the country? Made common sense. I'm gonna go study other coaches. So in my mind, this is where I went way wrong. In my mind, a coach was tough-talking, relentless, snarky at times, no gray area, black and white, mean, basically. I don't know, you older people know Bobby Knight. That's who I tried to emulate. Stupid. Or Pat Summitt. Or if you're in the gymnastics world, Marta Caroli. Worse. And our team, the year I took over, the year before, we had finished second. By half of a tenth. The year I took over, we came in dead last. So I figured, well, obviously I didn't study hard enough. So I learned to say things like, winners make adjustments and losers make excuses. And I heard somebody say it to a coach whose husband had just gotten through kidney cancer, and they finished like second in the country, and this coach said, winners make adjustments. Anyway, so true story. I realized at that time I was not cut out for this job. I didn't believe I had failed because I don't believe in failure. I believe that our athletic director was totally wrong in giving me the job. And absolute true story, when we make the movie about this, it's gonna be really a fabulous scene. I'm walking through Ackerman Union on my way to resign, and I come across Coach Wooden's book on leadership. Now, this was my big miss. I studied people like Pat Summitt and Bobby Knight and Marta Caroli. I didn't study John Wooden. And the only reason I can think that I didn't is because he wasn't this like big, bold, charismatic type of person. That's my excuse, okay? But his book opened up magically to his definition of success. And it said, success is peace of mind in knowing you've done your best. And I read it again, because Coach had won 10 championships in 12 years. Coach Wooden was hailed as the greatest coach that ever lived. I am a coach. I am hired to win. Where does he talk about winning? Why doesn't he talk about monetary gain? Why doesn't he talk about it? I mean, growing up, I heard success was the corner office. You grow up in this city, success is driving around with that Mercedes emblem or BMW emblem or Range Rover emblem. That's success. And I read his definition again and again and again. And when I read it, the word you got bigger and bolder. Success is peace of mind in knowing you have done your best. And I had the biggest aha moment of my life. I had been trying to be somebody else. And at that moment, I realized, whenever you try to be somebody else, you will always be a second-rate them. And the worst part about it, those of you that are on social media, the worst part about it is it prevents you from being a first-rate you. You were born, as Al alluded to, special with a unique light. When you try to be somebody else, it prevents your own light from shining brightly. So I didn't resign. I went back to my office. I don't have an office. I went back to my cubicle. And in my mind, I went back to my office. I shut the door and I put my feet up on the desk, and that didn't happen. I went back to my cubicle and I thought, well, huh, what do I bring to the table? I have 17 years of classical ballet training. They've asked me to coach gymnasts. They work really hard. I know how to work really hard. They have to work through pain a lot. I work through pain a lot. Your point shoes, your feet are bloody constantly. I knew what it was like as a young woman to have body shaming issues. I knew what it was like to have to be in a leotard every day going through puberty. That is not fun. I knew what it was like to be around people and to dabble in disordered eating and to be around full-fledged eating disorders. But most importantly, I knew what it was like to prepare so well that when I was standing in the wings, I was calm, confident, and enthusiastic. And not lying, in the wings was a bucket for those dancers that didn't prepare well enough to be calm and confident and had to throw up before they went on stage, which I never understood. Why would you work so hard at something and be so stressed out about it? Why aren't you enjoying it? So when I translated that to our student athletes, they're waiting in the wings, and you can see this with gymnasts. They stand like this, and they're waiting for the judge to salute them before they go up on the event. I knew at that moment I could do that part of this job better than anybody else in the world. I just had to find people to do all the things I didn't know how to do, which was actually the gymnastics part. Just fine. So I scrapped everything that I had done. I scrapped all those stupid coaching quips, and I just became me, okay? I started thinking about, I'm gonna prepare them to perform. I'm gonna prepare them to be confident so that when they're standing on a stage like this having to get up a speech, they are calm and confident and enthusiastic. I'm gonna do that. And guess what? Because I'm at UCLA, and because we can recruit some of the best talent in the world, that started translating to winning. And I will never, ever forget, a few years later, one of my seniors said, "Miss Val, you have finally become a leader worth following." And I said, "Whoa, why?" And she says, "Because you're being authentic to yourself, and it's okay if you make a mistake. You're not trying to be somebody else." So I stayed true on course to that. We kept winning, winning, winning. And but the next big ask I had came in 1998. I had married our defensive coordinator, Bobby Field, who knew Coach Wooden. I never met Coach Wooden. I'd been at UCLA 15 years. I hadn't met Coach Wooden. So I asked Bobby, I said, "Listen, you know Coach, why don't you invite him over for dinner?" Just like I called up the head coach of UCLA before I was there and said, "This is my resume, can I be their dance coach?" Just invite Coach over dinner. He can say no. So my husband, who is a lot like Coach Wooden, very, very humble gentleman, said, and he's from the South, so I have to do the Southern accent. He said, "My love, Coach Wooden has more invitations on his calendar than he knows what to do with. The last thing he needs is another obligation." I said, "He can say no." So the next night my husband came home, "Did you invite Coach Wooden to dinner?" "My love, I just don't wanna make," I said, "He can say no." Okay, ladies, this went on for 3 weeks straight. And finally, I think to shut me up, my husband called Coach Wooden and said, Coach, I don't know if you know, but I married our women's gymnastics coach. And Coach said, oh, Bobby, I know all about Miss Val. And Bobby said, well, you know, Coach, I know that you have a lot on your plate. We would love to invite you over for dinner, but I don't want you to feel like it's another obligation. I've seen your calendar. You have 4 and 5 things a day you need to do. And Coach Wooden said, Bobby, I don't mean to interrupt, but are you inviting me over for dinner? Or are you giving me all the reasons you don't want me to come? So Coach Wooden came over for dinner. We had the early bird special because he was 80 at the time. We had dinner at 5:30. He stayed till 11:30. And that started a relationship that not only became close, but we became family. And especially in the last 5 years of his life, my husband and I were with him, and his daughter, Nan, in particular, all the time. I would go over to his house and watch football games when Bobby was off coaching. Coach Wooden came to every single gymnastics meet. We had our team over at his house all the time. My husband and I were in the hospital with him the last day he died. That would have never happened if I had not nagged my husband, if we had been afraid to make the ask. Because he could have said no, and I wouldn't have taken it personally. And I swear to you, I have not told my husband I told you so, not once. All right, so I'm going along, I'm loving my job, we're winning championships, all is good, Pac-12 Coach of the Century, woohoo. And I get a call from my doctor, and she says, are you in the car? I said, yeah. She goes, you need to pull over. I'm like, well, this isn't good. And she says, I've got to tell you, your test came back and you have breast cancer. You have a very aggressive form of breast cancer, and I need you to get in as soon as possible. And at that moment, my world stopped, because the only other time I had dealt with cancer in my life was with my mother's death. 25 years prior, she died a very difficult, painful death with colon cancer. So as I'm sitting in my car and my world has stopped and I'm preparing myself for that, I hear very, very clearly, be anxious for nothing and grateful for all things. And whether you personally translate that to cosmic energy coming to me or the universe speaking to me, I translated that as God speaking to me. And I heard it again. Be anxious for nothing and grateful for all things, which did not sit well with me at all, because I had just gotten told I have a potential fatal disease. And I went home, and I told my husband the not so great news about the breast cancer. And then I told him, but get this, I heard be anxious for nothing and grateful for all things. And he said, yeah, it's from the Bible. Well, I had never read the Bible. I grew up Greek Orthodox. The Bible's in ancient Greek. I don't read ancient Greek. So I went over the Bible. I looked it up, and sure enough, black and white in Philippians 4, it says, be anxious for nothing, and then paraphrased, and grateful for all things. Once again, my world stopped. I heard this before I ever read it. This was a commandment. And like every single thing we do in life, it was a choice. I could choose to obey or not. So I chose to obey, be anxious. I was not going to be anxious, but I had no idea how I wasn't going to be anxious. I was in the fight for my life. And I went to the oncologist the next day. She had this big smile on her face, which I thought was very odd. And she says to me, the type of breast cancer you have gone from having the worst type to the best type. Because had you been diagnosed 10 years prior, HER2 positive, we had nothing for you. just if I'd been diagnosed 10 years prior. And she said, now, and the word choose came up again. If you choose to get chemotherapy for a year, if you choose to get surgery, I know it will work. At that moment, I understood the commandment. How I was not going to be anxious was through gratitude. I didn't have to get chemo. I got to get chemo. I didn't have to go through surgery. I get to go through surgery. And that's why I'm here today, to be able to say going through breast cancer was the best thing that ever happened in my life, because it's changed every moment of my life since then. When I change the word have to get to, it changes your entire outlook on your life, and your whole life opens up in living color. And I was thrilled to be able to share this journey with our student athletes. And so I called it my chemo spa. And I used to tell them on Thursdays, I'm gonna go to my chemo spa. And they would say, Miss Val, you don't have to put such a positive spin on it. I said, I'm not. A spa is someplace you go to get better. And you know, sometimes those extractions, they hurt. It's okay, you're there to get better. I'm going to my chemo spa to get better. My favorite memory of this whole thing was when I told our student athletes, they were sitting here just like you, and as soon as I told them I had breast cancer, they start looking at my boobs, right? And I'm thinking, teaching moment, because the tumor was the outside of my breast. And it did not feel like what we're told it's supposed to feel like, a hard little round pea thing. It felt like a long pulled muscle. And so I said, would you like to feel what a malignant tumor feels like? And so one by one, they came up and felt it, and the sirens are going off in my head. The HR is gonna come down and fire my ass. But I did not care. This was too important of a teaching moment for these young women. So as I'm sitting in my chemo spa, I realized that I knew I wasn't gonna die from breast cancer. But I also realized that we all have an expiration date. We all do. We don't want to talk about it. We don't want to think about it, but we do. And none of us know what date that is. So I don't fear that at all. But what I want to make sure that I don't do is waste one day of my life. So I was sitting in my chemo spa and I start writing my book, because that was on my bucket list. And I'm in my chemo spa and I develop a deck, a treatment for an urban nutcracker, because I danced nutcracker for 15 years and I want to make it urban and bring a different audience to the nutcracker. And I'm on my chemo spa and I'm developing a Broadway show based on the environment and the ecology, because we need to start taking, I started doing my bucket list in my chemo spa. And when people ask me why I'm retiring, I'm writing the crest. We just came off of another national championship. We're getting over 10,000 people for every single meet in Poly Pavilion. Why now? It's because I am so excited about my life and there's so much I want to do. I want to go share everything that I have learned with as many people as I possibly can. And so through all of this, I really want to finish with getting you to understand what Al started talking about, and that is your uniqueness. You're here for a reason. In the history of human beings on this planet, there has never been another you. And there never will be another you. And whether you share your light on a broad stage or on a smaller stage, you're still sharing it, and you're meant to share it for a reason. And so the title of my book, Life is Short, Don't Wait to Dance. Dance is obviously a metaphor for anything in life that makes your heart sing. Do not waste one day not fueling your heart and your soul and your light. And when you fuel that light, please make sure to share it with other people. You gotta fuel the light, you gotta be the light, you gotta share the light. The title of the book also is an homage to Coach Wooden. This is where you get out the tissues. During his later years Every time I was with him, somebody said, "Coach, you've led an impeccable life. Do you have any regrets?" And he would always say, "I have one regret. My wife, Nellie, loved to dance. And I was always very shy, and I would have never been a good dancer. And I realize now that had I danced with my wife, people wouldn't have made fun of me. They would have seen a couple that were so much in love. They loved to dance with each other. If I have one regret, and if I could do it all over again, I would dance with my wife." So thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you.